Today we are going to talk about high ability for Postgres using open source tools. Yeah, myself, Hari Krishna, and with me, my colleague, Jovin Augustine. Yeah.
Yeah, myself, Jobin. I am into this data center operation for last 16 plus years. So worked on different database technologies. So high availability is one of my favorite area.
So whenever the word high availability comes into mind, I mean, everything is so, I mean, we need not really go with the introduction part. So this is just us. We are working with Power OpenSAG. You can reach us at the following email address, and you can call us anytime if you have any questions, concerns regarding the session. Yep. Let's get started.
So when we talk about high availability, so there are different levels of availability. So for most of the users, we don't need a very complicated solution. So we have many users dealing with their availability solution using simple scripts. Say if the master fails, it can switch over to the slave. So there will be a little bit of downtime. So based on the business requirement, you know, what are the nines associated with the availability? Two nines, three nines, and up to six nines we are talking about. So we can see how much downtime per year is allowed as per the five nines requirement. So you're a client, or people will be asking to meet specific requirement of 99.999% of availability. So in that criteria, the five nines allows us to have 5 minutes in a year downtime. But today we are going to talk about even next level. So even in a few seconds, we can have a complete failover to a when a disaster strikes. So today we are going to see some of the demos. Hari will be giving you a demonstration of how the disaster scenarios will be handled. Yeah, so this clear, right?
Yeah, just wanted to ask one question. How many of you in this audience has really been using high availability in Postgres world, actually? I know that for Oracle and other stuff, you have a lot many options, but for Postgres ecosystem, how many of you have been using high availability? Yeah, and may I know what kind of high availability solutions are you have worked on so far?
PG pool.
Okay, PG pool, that's good. Yeah, any other? Okay. Pacemaker. Yeah, Pacemaker and Corosync. Yeah, that's even one of the very good HA solutions. It's found in the community wise. Yeah. Okay, so we're going to talk about, we are not here to talk about any one particular solution, or we're not trying to compare this particular solution with others, and not trying to show that this is the best or that is the worst thing. We have just explored one of the tools, and we just want to experience, and we just want to pass that knowledge and share our knowledge that how this tool is going to work in your environment. And this solution is not one fit, okay? Saying that, what does it mean that any availability solutions will not have one fixed solution for that, actually. It may work in your environment, it may not work in an environment. Okay, so depending upon your business case and all of that, so we need to go about and see that how it happens, actually. Yeah.
Yeah, so when we compare HS solutions, say your requirements may vary based on, say, two nines or three nines or what is required. So when we compare HR solutions, we need to compare few of the basic features. Say like when we compare two cars, so what are the features we are looking for? Okay, ABS braking, airbags. What are the features which we should really check and compare? So like Hari mentioned, we are not to advocate any particular solution. So what are the features we should be really comparing, by which we can identify the best solution which works for you? So these are the normal HA challenges which we should keep in mind when we evaluate some solution. So first is we are losing the master, so we need to elect a new master. Master election is the basic criteria. So it should be done in as quick as possible. And the entire restructuring of the cluster, say when a new master comes up, all other nodes need to follow the new master. So it's a kind of topology change. It should happen quickly and in a robust way. And the second point, this is something which many of the HS solution forgets, the split brain problem. Yeah. So those who are coming from other database world will be experiencing about this problem because they have solution and they are aware about this problem. So I'll be talking more about this split brain problem and how these solutions are handling that in detail later on. Very important thing we need to keep in mind. We need to handle split brains, otherwise you are in a trouble. And the third point is how we can rejoin the failed node to the cluster back. It should be seamless. So should not, and the cluster should be ready to accept the new the failed node back to the cluster. And say suppose you want to scale up, adding new nodes should be easy. And prevent false failure. There are many cases where the cluster got into confusion and thought that there is a real downtime and done the failover, even though there was a real case. So false failovers can happen in a HS solution. We should have a mechanism to prevent that. And protection against race condition and conflicts. So this is we'll cover later on in detail. There are many places the race condition can, because it's a cluster, many people are there. Say when we have many nodes are there, every node can get into a conclusion, okay, this failed or not failed. There could be decision-making problems. So we should protect the cluster from any such scenarios. So we are going to see that. And from an application perspective, application should be able to connect to the cluster, and application should be unaware about what is happening in the cluster. It should work seamlessly. There should not be any configuration change in the application side if there is a failover happening. So automatic and transparent application failovers, connection failovers is one of the major requirement of HS solution. So, and the last point is we need to use some standard components which is proven in the industry. Because if you are writing your own scripts, you may end up in many bugs, which is not proven. And the entire setup should be easy to do. Because you may have to do it in multiple times. Yeah, so whether we have some standard tools and components, that is one criteria. So these are the major criteria by which we need to compare different HS solutions.
Yeah, so just wanted to walk over to that today. What we are going to do is we will have a small demo of actual how the HS solution, what we're talking about, is being built up actually. We're going to do a small failover, a switchover and a failover, and see that how seamless the application connections are transferring without any code changes actually. Because that is what the excitement is all about, that everybody talks about HS solutions in the market or in the community world, especially in the Postgres world. But we really need to know that how robust and how rock solid that solution is actually. So we're going to have a small demo for that, okay? And we're going to talk about the Petroni thing, the whole component or the HS solution, what we have built on it, okay? Yeah, and the different components of HA, what goes into this HA solution, the HCD, Petroni, and stuff like that. Okay, and the most important part here is the RAFT algorithm, which is the crux of this entire HA solution, actually. Okay, this is, mind that, this is a very, very interesting piece, the RAFT algorithm. So please bear with us for that quick demo, actually. So we'll have a kind of two demos for the entire session. One will be the demo of the failover. The second demo would be for the RAFT algorithm, for getting the consensus for the distributed mechanism. And of course, we'll have a Q&A session at the end. However, I would request to hold on with your questions till the end of the session, actually. Okay, yeah. So let's jump to the, yeah. So before going to the HA demo part, I just wanted to take a look at this high-level picture. We are going to deal with each of these components as into the later slides. So this is just a high-level picture where we are going to have three nodes, okay? PG0, PG1, PG2, PG3, okay? Okay, and between them, all of them is having a Petroni, So right now, you just take it for granted that there is a component called as Petronium, which is running in all of the clusters, all of the nodes. Okay, HCD is the component which is the crux, which is trying to get the consensus from all of these nodes and passing that information to Petronium. And of course, the HA proxy, which we know everybody, is a kind of load balancer, which is trying to reroute the connections, application connections. Just for time being, just take this as the thing, and then we'll work on that. Okay, we'll come back to each of these components in the later stage. Is that fine? Yep. Yeah, so before that, this is just a small infrastructure details, what we are going to have it. So that is PG0 is playing a primary role. It has incoming components called HCD Petroni. PG1, of course, is a replica. So what we are going to do is have one master, two replicas, okay? And inbuilt, they're doing a streaming replication between them, actually. Okay, and of course, HA proxy is there, which is running on one of the nodes, actually, which is rerouting the connections, okay, which is going to be see the how seamless these connections will fail over, actually, without any manual intervention. Okay, yeah, so.
And one thing to remember, here we are reusing the HA proxy as one of the slave, and consider this as the application server also, because we don't have the infrastructure to demo everything using multiple nodes.
Yeah,
so we are using three machines, like explained here, and this consider this as the application server, but we are using that as one of the replica also. Okay?
Yep. So you can see that on the first, this thing. So you have the PG0, which is acting as a master, actually, PG1 as a slave, and HA proxy for timing, as Jomin mentioned, it is also acting as a slave, and it is playing a dual role of a slave as well as an HA proxy, actually. So HA proxy you can install on an application server also. Okay, so now we have this three node cluster, one is a master, two slaves, actually. Now what we are going to do is, we are going to fail it over. Now, to actually simulate this production-like environment, we see that failover is happening, switcher is happening. But the actual interesting part where everybody is excited or interested to see is how the application's connection is failing over, and that too seamless, and that too in a transparent manner. So what we have done is we have written a small Python kind of a code which is trying to act as an application code, actually, and which is trying to connect to the master. Okay, yeah, so this is the application, okay, which is trying to do this, okay? On one window, it's trying to connect to the master, which is the 90. You can see that PG0 is the 90 server, actually. It's trying to constantly insert the records in the master, actually. And now we are using this HA proxy for rerouting the read-only connections, actually. Okay, so for that, what we have done is we want to simulate that environment also. What we are doing is we are trying to have this the same. Yeah, sorry for this whole clutter, because I just wanted to show all of them in this so that I need not swap between the windows. So now this window is talking to the slaves, that is the two slaves. So now you will be wondering that why I can only see two. Okay,
yes.
So I'll just, yeah.
In nutshell, you have an application piece which requires a master connection. And there is another application piece which can talk to even slave. So you're reporting things. So two pieces. Your application, which one requires always a master connection, and another requires another one which can even talk to slave. So we are simulating that using the Python script. And
so here, yeah, sorry.
Yeah, just to what this Python script does is it will establish a connection. Say I want a master, so and it will stick to that connection until that connection fails. And if that connection fails, the exception handling will try to re-establish the connection. Again, it tells I want a master connection. So what happens in that case? So it's a small script, always trying for a master connection, one piece, and another piece, which is always trying to connect to a slave replica.
Okay, so now I hope you have got an idea, at least a high level idea, that how the setup is, how the application is trying to connect the master and the two slaves, actually, and then. Yeah, so now the first thing what we're going to see is a switchover part, okay? So now we have this PG0, I will just say, Yeah, don't go by the name failover. So failover here itself means switchover. So switchover is like a planned activity actually. We would do it in a planned downtime or an upgrade or kind of thing actually. Okay, yeah. So now it's asking that which candidate do you want to promote? I mean, so you want the HA proxy one or the PG one to be as a promoted as a master actually. Okay. So now I would say that let's make it PG one as a master. Okay, yeah, it's trying to get the confirmation. Are you sure you want to fail over to cluster stampede? Demoting current master PG0. It's asking the confirmation that PG0, do you want to demote it and promote PG1 as a master actually? Okay, so yes, I will say yes. Yeah, now you can see here, mind well, how the connections are now. Okay, yeah, okay, now can you see this? The master is PG1, it's got connected to the automatically. Is there any manual intervention we did? No, right? Absolutely not. And how much time did it take? Hardly 5 seconds, 10 seconds, that's it. And now within that same thing, okay, yeah, you can see this 90 connections there, and automatically the slaves is also getting updated. Now I will see that, let me show you that, what is the status right now? Yeah, now we have promoted the PG1 as the master actually. Earlier PG0 was the master actually. Now we promoted this. So this is the planned switchover. You're going to do it whenever you have a maintenance downtime actually. Okay, is this fine? So we got, what we saw is how the applications are seamlessly failing it over without any manual intervention. This is fine. Now what about an actual, your master going down actually? It's completely hard booting, hard rebooting kind of thing actually. Okay, wouldn't it be exciting to see that as well? And how does application connections fail over? Yes? Yeah, yeah, let's do that. Yeah, but how about directly killing that? Yeah, just rebooting the node itself? Yeah, so this is on PG1, this is the master actually, okay? I would just give a, okay? Oh, sorry. Yeah. Yeah, so I'm now trying to reboot the master actually. Okay, this is a hard reboot. So what we have to observe is how the application connections are failing over, first part, okay. Second part is, this node is going to get rebooted, okay. And after it's up, it's going to join the cluster again. And the interesting part, what we need to observe here is, it is going to join as a slave actually. Yeah, sorry. This is switchover. This is a switchover. Yeah, yeah. So yeah, that's what I said. That failover, don't get confused by the term failover. It is a switchover. It's a planned activity actually.
Yeah.
Hmm. That's happening.
No.
Yeah. As I said, yeah. So that's the whole beauty of this, is that once the master, the current master is demoted actually, okay, it goes back and comes up again and it joins the slave and it's already syncing with the new master actually. Okay. Now we are going to see that as well actually. So now PG1 is the current master actually. We are going to reboot that thing because this is what an actual production like a scenario happens. And we always hope not to have the scenario, but we should be prepared for that. Okay, yeah? Now, yeah. Okay, yeah. So it is going to take a bit of time that machine to come up, join, okay, join, see that, okay, I was a master once, now I need to become there is already a master actually, okay, yeah, and now I need to become as a slave, because I cannot have, in a cluster, you cannot have two masters actually, because that's going to be a very nasty situation where it's going to corrupt the database actually, right?
Yeah. There is a case where we can allow data loss. So you know this synchronous replication and asynchronous replication. Yeah, current transaction will be aborted.
Yeah. So we are going to talk about all those things actually, that what kind of limitations or what caveats we would say with this kind of solutions we have it actually.
Yeah.
So all solution will not be 100% foolproof kind of one. Yeah.
Two slaves. Yeah, that's a leader election algorithm. Hari is going to give a detailed demo of that leader election algorithm. Yeah, just wait for. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Can you just yeah.
Yeah, that also we are going to cover. Yeah.
Yeah, 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 yeah. So I know that you are very curious to know that all of that. Please hold on with your excitement, and as you are also, we would like to entertain each and every question actually. And of course, you can walk to our booth and have a detailed demo also once again, or how many number of times you want it, we can have a demo and have a detailed brainstorming session over there as well actually. Okay, so if you see there, PG1 has come up. Okay, the PG0 is the leader now. Okay. Now you might be wondering why PG0 became the leader or HAProxy did not become the leader, because that's what we are going to talk about, how the PG0 got the leader actually. Okay, so there is a algorithm behind that actually. There's a configuration parameter involved in that which makes PG0 become the master and not the slave or HAProxy, because there is a lag failover, maximum lag failover configuration parameter there. It's a configurable item actually. Okay, based on that, whichever slaves is the most, the recent one, it becomes the master actually. Yeah, so that I guess that answers some of your question, I hope. Yeah, so now this was the whole demo about actually. I hope that we have covered the two scenarios. One was the switchover part and one was the failover part. And we saw that how seamless these application connections are there. There is no manual intervention. There is nothing actually. Just to simulate the load also, we did that. And obviously, in a production environment, there will be a lot much more load actually. But this is what we could come up with in a demo environment. Yep. That's fine.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And both in planned downtime and unplanned situation, the actual downtime was split seconds, like maybe 5 seconds, more, not more than that.
Yeah. So now coming back again to the architecture diagram, actually. So we did have this. The overview of that, I just want to revisit this architecture again and saying that, okay, we did see that some of the pieces, things like you saw that all that magic happening, but what's behind that? What's underneath that actually? So Petroni is one of the stuff actually, is one of the component actually, okay? And of course the HCD, which is the core of the entire consensus we are trying to get it actually. Okay, HAProxy, we know that it's purely used being as a load balancer and rerouting the connection side. Okay, yeah. We're going to dig into each of those components in this coming slides. Yeah.
Yeah. So these are the features of Petroni as a HA solution. So as we know, it's a self-healed. So we didn't do anything. So we had disaster. The node got rebooted. But itself, the entire cluster self-healed. And we don't have an external monitoring tool to do anything. And we should not have, actually, for a good HA solution. It monitors itself. The nodes will monitor itself. It works like a family. So when some of your family member is sick, we don't have an external monitoring saying that your family member is sick. The other family members conclude, okay, this person is sick, and take to doctor. So that's what self-healed and self-monitored. And we can have manual as well as scheduled switchover. So we saw the manual one, yeah. And automatic failover when a disaster strikes. And we saw how a node rejoins the cluster once it got rebooted. It seamlessly rejoins once it is up. As a slave, not as a master, because we already have a master. And in the backend, it uses PG Rewind, which is completely hidden from you as a user. The complexity is completely hidden. Yeah. So and customized replica creation methods. So we can do that as well.
Yeah, I just wanted to add. Somebody pointed out whether what kind of replication are we using that. So you have the choice of asynchronous as well as synchronous. But we do know that the trade-off between the synchronous and asynchronous one actually. So as a best practice, we always try to have an asynchronous one actually. Okay. So in this case, it is asynchronous replication. But it's your business requirement. If it really demands for that kind of, you can go for synchronous replication. But you know there is a trade-off between that. There's a cost involved in that actually.
So in the synchronous replication, the data will be committed in the slave and get acknowledged back that it is committed. So then there will be delay. So in Oracle world, we call it maximum protection mode. That's same thing can be implemented in Postgres as well.
Yeah, dynamic configuration.
Yeah, so the major point is dynamic configuration. We won't be demoing that here. So on the fly, we can modify some of the parameters. Normally what happens is, suppose you modify some parameter in the master and forgot to do the same thing in the slaves. And later you done a switch over. You will end up in surprises. Oh, things which were working earlier, suddenly it's not working. So the clustering solution, the high availability solution should take care that all the changes you do in the master, the same configuration changes are done in the slaves as well. So when there is a switch over, there should not be any surprises. So that's done. And we have a post mode. Yeah, so we won't be demoing that. So what it means is we explicitly tell the cluster, don't do a switch over now because we are doing some planned activities. Don't use your intelligence now. So pause it for some time. And transparent application connection failover, we already saw that. So the techniques behind all these things we'll be explaining in the coming slides. So why do we need a distributed consensus? So the main point here is we don't have a single point of decision making and failure. So if there is only one node taking decision, so the master fail or the slave, there is the cluster is having some problem. The single point become a single point of failure. And the one person can get confused. Same happens in a cluster. So we have a distributed consensus algorithm. We will be seeing the demonstration of that in the coming. So that is the main point. We need to have that always. Then only the cluster will be intelligent enough to take a right decision. So another thing is the leader election. So the second point and third point are kind of say the leader election also need to have a consensus, like a democracy. So who gets the maximum vote should be the leader. And not only that, he become the leader. After becoming the leader also, he need to get the consensus from the people on the decisions he's taking. So he's not an autocrat after that. So it's a pure democracy. So leader election happens using the cloud, the cluster members. And after becoming the leader, he consult with the nodes. Can I do this? Yeah, so then every decision gets the consensus. So there won't be any mistake, any surprises. And the concept is like the leader gets a leader key. So it's kind of authority, so to become a leader. So the leader key will be there for only 30 seconds. So if within 30 seconds the leader is not revalidating himself, the key expires, just like our, the leader gets out of the leadership role. The major point is, if in case the leader is lost, leader key expires, every node in the cluster should be seeing the same thing. Okay, we no longer have a leader. So that is where the distributed consensus comes into picture. It is not a single point of decision making, it's a distributed way of decision making. That's the beauty of this algorithm, and Hari is going to give a video on that, how it works.
Yeah, so just to go over that, what are the components of HA? HCD is there, Petron is there, Watchdog is there, HA proxy is there. So one new thing what you're going to see here is Watchdog. You might have already been heard about that or might be using already. But how this Watchdog is really helping to double check that you don't end up in a split brain kind of a scenario, actually. Okay, we are going to talk about that as well. Okay, so, yep. So the first thing is HCD, which is the core of the distributed mechanism. Okay, so it's a distributed key value store. So wherever you might have heard deployed or used HA solutions, and you have multiple nodes for that, and you want to really play around with the number of nodes actually, and you need to really get the consensus from that. So either you store them in a kind of a table format and say that, okay, a leader one or master one is one, okay, and so on and so forth. Okay, so but here is a distributed key value store actually, which is extremely lightweight, and that's the whole beauty about this component is it's extremely fast actually, and that's what we are going to see that. It's benchmark almost 10,000 writes per second, talks REST, okay, implements Raft, okay. We are going to see what Raft algorithm is all about. Okay, consistency guarantee to implement database leader, okay. It gracefully handles leader elections actually, and we are also going to see that if there are in a situation where you have multiple leaders, okay, how the split vote is going to get resolved on its own actually, okay, because this is what a common scenario you will end up in HA solutions actually, okay, yeah. And key expiration with TTL and rest of the operations. Yeah, Raft, I would say just a distributed consensus algorithm achieves consensus by directing all changes to the leader actually. So once, as Jobin explained, so once the leader gets it, all the changes are propagated using to the leader, but it also needs to get consensus from the node as well actually. So it's not trying to really act as an autocrat, but it's really involving other members and it's kind of an inclusive decision actually, okay. Can only commit the changes if it's acknowledged by majority of nodes. Okay, it is trying to get an acknowledgement from the nodes, and then only it says that, okay, now let's commit that actually. Okay, two stages, leader election, log replication, and implemented in HCD and console. Now, some of the things you might be wondering, what are these things? What are the leader election? What is consensus? Yeah, just hold on your anxiety for, yeah. So a lot, we will see a small demo of what this visualization is all about.
Yeah, understanding this algorithm is very important, not only from this Postgres HA solution. So this same algorithm is used across many solutions nowadays. You might have heard of Kubernetes. There are n number of upcoming technologies and growing technologies uses the same algorithm and same components behind. So understanding this will help you in many ways, not only from Postgres HA. Yeah,
so we know that a normal, when there are two nodes, there is no problem with the consensus, but the consensus comes into picture when you have multiple nodes in that. So Raft is an algorithm when you want to have a distributed consensus and when you have more than one node, and this is all about HA. Okay, so let's look at the node. So when you have, and each node will have each of the three states, the follower state, okay, the candidate state, candidate is a prospective leader, okay, or the leader state actually. Yep. All nodes start in the follower states. So when we are referring the nodes, these are nothing but the database nodes actually, okay? So if the followers don't hear from a leader, then they become a candidate, okay? Now this is how the votes is going up. The candidate requests the votes from the other nodes. Nodes will reply with their votes, okay? Yeah? The candidate becomes the leader if it gets a vote from the majority of votes, okay? So if it gets the majority, okay, then it becomes, this process is called a leader election actually. The first thing what it needs to do is it has to vote for itself, then it's going to ask vote for the others, and depending on the majority, it. So all changes to the system, once it's got the leader, now it's going through the leader actually, okay? Yeah? So each change is added as an entry in the node's log, and that's how it is going to get propagated to the other nodes. The log is currently uncommitted, so it won't update the node's value. The committed, the entry, the node first replicates to the follower nodes, okay? It is going to update the follower nodes. Once it gets committed, then it's only going to get updated its own list. The entry is now committed on the leader node, and the node state is 5, okay? The leader then notifies the follower that entry is committed. You want to take a pause for a minute?
So you got this point, right? So this node was master already, and it has to update a value. It's not clear. It's a value to 5.
Check 5. Yeah.
5. And to set a value to 5, it has to consult with the other nodes in the cluster and got consensus from them, and then that value is updated. So leader is, even though that's already a leader, the leader is not taking decision itself. Every decision is propagated to the members in the cluster, and then get the consensus, then that is committed.
Now this is called a log replication actually. Now whatever you failover you saw, that who's becoming the master, who's becoming the slave actually. So all that behind this is the raft algorithm actually. Okay, now one more case what we want to see really see is how the leader election happens actually. This is again a quick demo actually, which will clarify some of your doubts. I know that this is going to be a bit Greek and still there will be a lot of confusion kind of thing actually. Okay, yeah. Now in there are two types of settings are there, and this is what Jobin was talking about, that the leader has to get the consensus from the other members in a particular timeout, election timeout. That timeout is called election timeout. Is the amount of time follower waits until becoming a candidate. Now if you see, I am sorry for this, but this is a bit blurred. You will see the term. There is a term, term one, term eight. So each term is nothing but it's a random 150 milliseconds to 300 milliseconds actually. And this is the duration where the election happens again and again. And whenever you get the consensus, okay, and if there is a kind of a split out, again, there is a new term is going to get initiated for that. Okay, yeah. The election timeout is randomized between 150 milliseconds and 300 milliseconds, okay. Now, if you see the picture clearly, I mean, just observe it for a thing. So the timeout is happening actually around the blue circles, okay. After the election timeout, the follower becomes a candidate, okay, and vote for itself first thing, okay. If you see that term, term one, vote count one, node B actually, one, okay, and sends out the request to the others. Then the moment it gets the vote, okay, then it votes.
We need to have a YAML file specifying all the Postgres related configuration as well as some of the cluster related configurations. So these values are stored inside the etcd cluster as key value store. It is not stored in postgres.conf. Remember that. Because if you store in postgres.conf, it will be node specific. So every time when Postgres starts up, it gets the value from etcd. Yeah. So you need not remember everything, but that's the idea behind. So the values are stored across. So, and the Petroni uses REST API to manipulate all these. It really doesn't matter. Say, this time it credited as 9 o'clock or 10 o'clock, that's fine. But if it is saying that the salary is credited and it is not reflecting the balance, then that's a big problem. It's a business disaster. So that's what the split brain is. And most of these HS solutions are, the split brain solution to split brain problem is, if we are evicting and removing a node from mastership, we need to make sure that every processing happening in that node is getting killed or terminated, and that node is 100% down. There should not be a case where that node is still running and doing some data processing. So that is handled using watchdog. So when we say about a normal watchdog, it's kind of monitoring mechanism or things like that, kind of cute puppy, but this is a different watchdog, so previous one. Hmm. Yeah. Yeah, so this watchdog is going to kill the node which is going out of the cluster. So if it is not hearing the heartbeat mechanism, you say google.com, we may be hitting a proxy, and all the connections will be routed to thousands of servers behind. And this HA proxy is well known for its lightness and fastness. It can
running on a small device like a Raspberry Pi can saturate a fiber optical cable which is running in gigabits. So such a fast, and it is routing based on the layer 3 of TCP. So it is not really inspecting what is there in the packet. It is just working like a network router. So it's one of the fastest. A few examples are Stack Overflow. There are millions of hits every day. So we are using that. Yeah.
Yeah, so we did go through this HA solution. We know that there are a lot of questions around this actually, and then obviously like any other HA solution, there would be some caveats, some limitations, some things you need to really consider before going off this. So the one of the caveats which I would like to highlight here as such, or some gentleman already mentioned about, was what would be the data loss, and since we are using an asynchronous, there would be a data loss actually. So now the question was going to come up is how much. Okay, so that is really controlled by your maximum lag on failover before. So when you have two slaves actually, okay, and the master has gone down actually, and now which of the nodes should get promoted actually? So the nodes which is having the least maximum lag failover is the one is going to get promoted actually. So this is a configurable item, it's in terms of bytes. Verifies master before master promotion, which Jobin has already explained, that saying that to avoid the two diverse timelines actually. So what does it? It kills the node itself, so that Postgres is not up and is trying to accept connections and is trying to corrupt the data. That's the really an extremely important point. The last point is never ever use super users for this thing. I mean, it's not only about Petroni or HA solution, it's about across when you want to have it in a Postgres world, never ever use for super user reserved connections, because you're going to end up in a situation where you will have none of the connections, you will have all the maximum connection exhausted, and you will not even have one single connection to take a control of that database actually. So you don't want to do that. Okay. Yep. Sorry?
Yeah.
No, no. So that's what the entire cluster is homogeneous. So that is required for the failover scenario. So if one node is special, if we have a one node special, if we lose that one special node, it will create an unavailability or kind of confused situation.
Yeah, so these are some of the references. So this is absolutely open source tool, nothing out of the no commercial. So you can have these sites and build your own HA solutions for that. Yeah, I think I'm afraid, but we can, I think, have a couple of questions.
Yeah, quickly take two questions.
Yeah, but that's what, but
how
you.
Do you ensure that the Petroni configuration is same across all the nodes? Because there is a timeout setting, right?
Yeah, yeah. So that's what the question is, I would like to repeat. How do you ensure the Petroni configuration is the same across all of the nodes, right? Yeah.
And that content of the YAML file is stored into etcd cluster. So that is a that is a underlying infrastructure for this cluster. So it's not stored in any file. It is stored in across the cluster.
Yeah. Yeah. One thing So one thing I would like to highlight here is this HA solution you might have seen and really liked it, or you would like to explore it. But you might have also seen that there is a lot of, or you might be wondering, there is a lot of complexities involved, because there are so many components involved. Etcd is there, Petroni is there, YAML file is there, and blah, blah, and whatnot we talked about actually. Okay, and there is a lot of learning curve for this as well. Okay, how about having this entire cluster build with one single command? Wouldn't that be interesting? Yeah? And that one cloud, and maybe on AWS, Azure, Google also? Yes, that's really possible, and we have done that. And this is one of the working clusters on AWS. You can see that you have three node cluster actually with two HA proxies running actually to have the redundancy actually. So this is all done as a custom solution, what we have built it, but the underlying thing is the same Petroni part. With one single command, you can spin up the entire HA cluster, okay, with one single command on any cloud, Azure, AWS, or Google actually, without any manual intervention. So otherwise, if you had to do that, it's take a lot of time, efforts, and a lot of mastery and skills for that actually. So if you're really interested to see how this is done, you can walk over to our booth, okay, and have a demo for that as well actually. Okay, yeah? Yeah, so I'm afraid, but thank you for your patience. Hope you liked it actually, yeah. If you have any further questions, please do walk over to our booth. Yeah, thanks very much.
Thank you so much, Hari and Jobin.